Hi, how are you doing? That bad? Come on, guys. Luis, you're supposed to warm them up. All right. So, really cool to be here. I'm Evgeny, and today I'd like to tell you a bit about Zero Turnaround and a bit about my life post Zero Turnaround. So, if I look back, it's actually quite cool to look back because I actually, when I put this down, I've done quite a lot of things in quite different areas. And, you know, I've always been an engineer. I started writing code when I was 14. I actually had my first software company when I was like 16 years old. And I was building utilities for Windows, like Task Manager and some optimization and something I don't even remember anymore. And it was quite successful for that time. It was the 99, 98. And, you know, I've made like thousands and maybe tens of thousands of dollars. So for a 16-year-old kid, that was pretty cool money. But then I just was a software engineer. I was a manager. I actually managed to do my doctorate. So my friends call me Dr. Kabanov. And then, of course, I started Zero Turnaround together with my co-founder, Thomas Römer. And over 10 years, we built it up and in the end sold it to Roguewave a little over a year ago. And so, of course, now I joined Taxify as the chief product officer. So this is the interesting bit because when I tell, usually when I sit with somebody and say that, okay, I'm now the chief product officer, the first question is, what the hell? So, and there's two questions usually because essentially I chose like after I sold the company, I could have retired to a nice private beach somewhere, you know, and spent the rest of my life in a tropical paradise. But instead, I chose to sit behind a long table with like 8 other people and work on like making sure that Taxify products are amazing. And so I get 2 questions: why, like, why did I actually not go to a tropical beach? And the second is like, why didn't I build something by myself? And I actually have quite good answers for that. It was a really interesting moment. After I sold my company, I had this unique moment in my time, the second time in my lifetime, where I could do absolutely anything. Like, you know, when you go from high school and you choose which university to go to, like, what kind of career track to pursue, like, it feels like all the roads are open. You could do, like, anything, and it's, like, almost, like, too much. Like, you don't know, you know, you could do anything, but you can only do, like, one thing at a time. So I had exactly the same thing. Like, I literally built an Excel with all the different options. You know, I could go study, I could go teach, I could go to public service, I could start my own company, I could go work for somebody, like, all the different options. And I actually like ended up analyzing that through. I decided that this is the best option, that I really want to go join something great, join something that's growing quickly, that has a lot of impact, that has complex technology, complex products. And I also don't want to do my own thing for the next few years because I want somebody else to be not sleeping at night, preferably Marcus. So this was a quite actually quite, for me, like quite an interesting lesson learned that, like, you know, that when you stop and think about it, then everybody talks, yeah, you got to do entrepreneurship. But it's not always the best choice. You got to always figure out what is the right thing for yourself. What is the right thing for yourself right now? And sometimes it might be like, you know, do your thing. And I did that once. And I did, you know, I did teaching and I did studying and I did engineering. And, you know, and now it feels like I want to go build stuff and have somebody else worry about the leaking toilets in the building. So this is my life now. But going back, like, you know, for the last 10 years, my life has been this. And if I'll just say a couple words about Zero Turnaround, if you don't know. Like, Zero Turnaround was founded by 2 engineers at a very, very kind of this computer science premise that we wanted to help other engineers build software faster, and we had a very complex solution to a quite complex problem. Basically, for particularly the Java platform. So on the Java platform, if you write software, like, and if you change a line of code, then to see the effect of that line of code on your probably very, very complex piece of software, you have to jump through quite a lot of hoops. You have to compile it, assemble it, deploy it to the server, start up the app. So, like, the whole process, which takes like 3 to 15 minutes every time you want to see what change did you do. And I was at the same time where like JavaScript and PHP and all else were like boasting like, you know, change whatever you want, hit refresh, and you got it. And so we built this quite complex piece of software. We released it, and surprisingly, it like worked really, really well. And we managed to build quite a big company around this. So we raised like a fair bit of money. We reached tens of millions of dollars of revenue. And what's actually was also quite cool about it that we got funded by Bain Capital Ventures, which was one of the top tier VC funds. And absolutely in a random way, like the reason we got funded by Bain Capital Ventures is because we had a deal with another VC who, looking back, would be like quite a lot worse, like was like not even a third tier VC. And we had the deal and it was done, and then they bailed out at the last minute. And we had a friend that during this process, like we had like some friend of a friend who basically was like, guys, you know, if you have a cool company, like if anything doesn't work out, like, you know, like just I could also bring some other investors in. And we're like, and when it didn't work out, we're like, yeah, okay, whatever, you know, bring them in. And so he brings them in. And I didn't even then, like I was just meeting the guys, we were negotiating the deal. Like we were profitable, we didn't care much about that. We wanted, like there was some secondary that we needed to do. So we didn't, it wasn't even for us like a big deal. And later, you know, we figured out that, okay, we actually got one of the top VCs in the world. So it was, it gave us access to unlimited resources to really, really high tier people who have built companies before. And specifically at that time, like even like we understood engineering, but like sales, marketing, operations, that was a whole other thing that we needed to learn. So this is a really interesting experience. And it's always funny for me how random that whole thing was, right? And how much differently the company would probably turn out to be if we would have taken the first deal instead of the second one. And at that time, we didn't even know that it's anyhow important. So serendipity always plays a big, big role in all of these things, right? The other thing that we were also lucky is that actually our biggest office was in Boston. Like we had 100 people in Boston. We had over 80 sales people in Boston. Then it was Talent, there was Tartu. But interestingly enough, Zero Turnaround was actually founded here in Tartu. And our first office was in Tartu, the second was in Tallinn, and then Prague, and then Boston. So it was also interesting how the whole geography played out, because the reason why Boston was the biggest is that that's where the sales and marketing like muscle was. That was when we could hire really, really good people who have built this thing a lot before. But again, it also shows how much has changed in the last 10 years, or even 5 years, because today I think Estonia has quite significant sales and marketing aptitude. Like, whereas 5 years ago, I thought that it was, you know, it wasn't useful to open a sales office in Estonia. So today, I probably would not even open a Boston office. I would just keep everything here, because I think we have reached the point where we have the capacity to compete on the world stage, not just as engineers, as designers, but also as business people. So. So it was really cool. It was a really cool journey. You know, this is the photos from our consecutive trips before the company became just too big for that. The last one is 120 people, and the first one, I think, 20 people. And, you know, living through that was a privilege, and I'm really, really happy because we had an amazing team, and it was just absolutely amazing to come to work every day with the people who are excited about the job, who are great at it, and you know, and who are pulling in the same direction with you. But today, and so the thing that I wanted to, you know, stop at is what did I learn from all that, right? So I tried to condense the lesson into like a very simple one. So I always like to share something that I've learned. And basically, the biggest thing by far I learned from Zero Turnaround is that first you look at the market, then you look for the product, then you look for the business, and then maybe profit comes one day. Seems super boring, but it was actually quite interesting because at Zero Turnaround, they built in the end 6 products. From them, 2.5 were successful. The jury's still out on the last one. So I say like 2 I'm sure about, one is like still 50-50. Because we built 6 products, each of those products was like a startup on its own. It had its own market, it had its own business, like they're all very different. And so the first product, Jerable, that I mentioned before, that one actually was an accident in many ways, right? So this is a very interesting thing, that the first product of companies is very often an accident. And it's an accident in the point that basically survivor bias works there, because if it wouldn't be, if the first product that you came up with, if it didn't have a market, and if it didn't have a, like a decent product market fit, there wouldn't be a company. Like, there would just not be a company, because to have a company at all, you have to have something in the beginning. But since there's a lot of people trying things out, then, you know, sooner or later, something is going to happen. Obviously, like, you know, the better you understand the market, the mortality or so on, it's the chances increase. But in the end, like, for me, like, even though, you know, we had a wonderful first product, our second product was a complete flop. Exactly because, looking back, I think the first product, we just, like, the stars aligned, right? And we, it wasn't just, you know, we knew that it solves a big engineering problem, and we believed that there's a big, big like market for it, but it could just as well be not. So when I think about markets today, this is the other thing that I learned. I always think not about some abstraction, but I always think in terms of specific people. Like, for me, market isn't like some kind of like a marketing abstraction or category or something. For me, market is like 20 guys who sit in a company, who have a problem, who might accept a solution that I'm proposing, and who have access to money, who can either pay or have access to somebody who pays. And so I always, whenever now I think about anything new, I always think, okay, who are those 20 guys? Like, how do they look like? What do they, you know, like, what do they read? How do I get to them? And I always think very, very specifically. And I'll tell you why, because when we built our first product, everybody was asking us for the same thing. You know, you guys, it's Jerable, it's wonderful, it's magical, it's amazing. Like, it does this, now we can instantly update code and, like, see the results. We want the same thing, but in production. We want to update code live for, like, on our servers for the users, right? So we could make hot fixes, we could just roll features without the hassle. We're like, wow, that sounds cool. That sounds like 10 times the market that Jerable is. We're going to do it. So we spent, like, first year or, like, so doing it, and nobody wants it. Nobody wants it. Because it turns out that the people, those specific people who are asking, were different from those people who would be using the product. They're not the same people. Like, these are developers, and those guys are, well, very abstractly, not talking about specific, those guys are system administrators, operations, and so on. And they have a completely different set of problems. The thing with the instant update, that's like a, you know, number 20 on their list of priorities, what they care about. Developers think differently, but anyway, that was the first thing. We didn't think about the specific people. So once we started thinking about the specific people, once we started interviewing them, talking to them, we understood that, okay, yes, this is not quite the thing that they care about, but they do have a set of different problems, which is kind of adjacent, and we already built some features which kind of overlap with those problems. So let's build some more. Let's try to iterate on that, and let's improve it. So we spent, I think, 3 years, like, working, iterating, and we actually got to the point where I think we figured out who those people are, what do they want, what do they read, and what's the problem, where's the money, and then we promptly closed the product. So we actually closed the product when I believe we achieved product market fit. Why? Because of the third thing, the business. So not only you need to have a market and a product, you also need to be able to scale the business. And when you build your first product, it doesn't matter much, because like you will tailor your business to your product, to your market. When you're building second, third, fourth products, then the business has to more or less align. You have to have, it either has to align with what you're doing, or you have to have enough resources to start a completely different business. Like, for example, at Taxify, you know, we generally have a consumer business, but like we also started a business product which sells, you know, which sells rights to businesses. And this is a completely different product. It has a completely different, you know, it needs like business sales, customer success, onboarding, like management, integration. So complete, and like in a small company, you can't do things like that. You can't just go and strap on a whole different business model on top of like your completely different business model, because if you do that, you know, your initial business model will crumble, because you can't focus on both of them. And so that's why we decided actually to close the second product. And now the third product, we actually went by this, we understood who, you know, that's the second product was okay, the learning failure, and then the third product we actually designed, and it was pretty successful. We found the market, we found the problems, we found the specific people, understood how they think, And we made sure that the business aligns with our existing business, right? So we kind of designed it to be all aligned as much as possible. We took calculated risks, and we actually achieved success. And then we kind of continued with this model, but maybe, you know, but it's just taking more risk in one case, less risk in the other, and with varying degrees of success, but at least we knew up ahead where the risks, where the rewards. So this is maybe, you know, this is a very simple lesson. It's been repeated many, many times, but I always like bringing examples because even though I read the things, like for me, when we were building the products, even though I knew the concepts, I thought I understood them, I still made all the basic mistakes you can make. And so the only other thing I want to talk about is that maybe the other lesson I learned is that just when once you have a product, once you have a market, it's all about the team. It's all about who do you hire, who's working with you. And probably the biggest thing I learned is that, you know, hire smart people, and not just like in engineering, not just in product, across the board. You know, with other things equal, I now value like kind of just raw ability to problem solve, to analyze higher than I value experience. Experience is important, but it has to come in tandem with that ability, right? Fire jerks, this was a painful lesson for us to learn because we initially only kind of hired, especially early on, just very strong technical guys, and a few of them were jerks, and then we had at some point to like, we understood that, okay, those guys are not actually, they're not contributing to the health of the team, so we did have to go through that. And the lesson that I also learned kind of repeated recently as I came to Taxify is measure inputs. So a lot of the modern kind of management theories, this OKRs and managed by objective and like all these things where you set goals and then you achieve them. And this is great. This is great for setting direction, but it's actually usually not that great at understanding people's performance and like how well do they do or how badly do they do. And Amazon, interestingly, does some of that, but it also measures inputs. So it measures what analysis do people produce, how deep they do this analysis, how correct decisions do they do, how do they solve problems, people problems, technology problems, whatever problems. Like, so they look at people at their direct output, like what is the work products they produce, and they measure those directly instead of measuring what would be the result of those, because the results, you know, the business results always depend on like a lot of market and serendipity and like, you know, and all the other people that work with you. But the things that you produce directly, they depend only on you. And so this is the best way of understanding whether the people are actually doing good work or not so great. And it kind of fell out of favor today, but I still think that like while you should measure outputs, you should also measure inputs. You should understand if the people are doing steps that will bring them on the right way. And also have hard conversations. The hardest problem in management is exactly that people usually know that there's an issue. They don't have hard conversation about splitting stock, like between founders. They don't have hard conversations when people don't perform. They don't have hard conversations when they know that the company is in trouble and they will need to. This is probably the biggest thing that also like a lot of these people failing. They're tough. They're annoying, but they just have to be had. And that was kind of my last lesson. And to finish, you know, it's all a game of luck to a point, but it also takes a lot of courage. It takes a lot of work. But you know, if you keep at it, you'll find you can keep trying and succeed in the end. Thank you.